for me. Looking back, I was sometimes up. Thank you.
Yes.
But Father God, we know your spirit is pervasive and gracious, and that you are still here with us, encouraging us, giving us life, and reassuring us that your mercy, your grace is forever. Oh, Father God, many of us are just hungry to be in fellowship with one another. Father God, it's so difficult for some of us who actually do live alone to have the extra addition of shelter in place added to that limitation. But Father God, in the morning light, this morning when I see the bright sunshine, the clearness of the skies, the gentleness of the breeze, I know that you are still with us.
Yes.
You are gracious and compassionate.
Yes.
Father God, I pray for so many who are yet receiving the medical treatment they need to be revived, to be strengthened, to be encouraged.
Yes.
And Lord, then I remember the newborn baby that you gave to this congregation, and I realize that this world will continue until you burst the clouds.
Yes.
And bring us back. Spring and the harvest will remain.
Yes.
And for this we thank you and give you praise and blessings. Father God, I pray for this church, this United Methodist Church, for those who are in leadership.
Yes.
Continue to give them wisdom and knowledge of how to lead the people, how to encourage them and strengthen them even in these trying times. I thank you for the pastor that you placed here in the righteous hands of the Lord. I thank you for the grace you.
Thank you, God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Father, you give so many good
blessings. Yes.
For this, I thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as the people of God, we will pray the word you gave us in
the Holy. Amen, amen.
Thank you.
are going to be times in your life as a believer when you're going to question if God is really on your side. And the reason why you're questioning it is because of the simple fact it seems like the devil is hitting you with everything that he can possibly throw at you. But you need to understand something, beloved. You need to remember that the only reason why you're in that position now is because God had ordered your steps. And the only reason why the devil is hitting you like he's hitting you is because he has literally peeked into your future. And he sees what God's about to bring you into. That's why you can't depend on nothing but the word of God.
Reverend Stinson said, today is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We won't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow has enough of its own problems. We will rejoice and be glad in this day. Rejoice, church. Every little day is going to be all right.
Amen.
Good morning, EPFM friends and family. So good to be back in the house of the Lord, but I miss seeing all your smiling faces here. Got a couple, but not everybody. May God bless and keep you until we meet again.
Amen.
Quick and shameless plug. Yesterday, I celebrated my 67th birthday. Praise God for whom all that you do. Now, back to God's business. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your love that is far beyond our understanding. Even though we cannot fully comprehend it, please help us to receive it, embrace it, and believe it with all we have. Prepare our minds, prepare our hearts as your word is brought forth in this message today. Bread of life, feed me till I want no more. In Jesus' majestic name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today's message was originated from a thought that's been in my spirit for the past few weeks. Little did I know, I was challenged to expound on and support it in public. Let's concentrate on two verses from Philippians 4. I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am in. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And today's message is entitled,
All right.
All of us now are in your face familiar with crisis. If 2020 has taught us anything, it has given us a chance to grow through difficult times. Our country is facing four crises at the same time: financial, health, racial, and political. Most people have lost the privilege of graduating, the joy of weddings, the closure of funerals, not to mention the inability to complete your day-to-day personal business. This was not the year any of us expected. How do we keep hope alive in the midst of a crisis? How do we keep believing God is still at work? How do we keep on keeping on when we've been primarily stripped of normality and restricted to just a portion of our life that once was? Now, our focus is on opportunities or material things we don't have, instead of appreciating what we do have. And we are overtly less thankful in these times of trial than in times of abundance. We thank God and declare his goodness when things turned out the way we hoped, but was that because our circumstances were easy? Should it be any different when our circumstances are hard? Should we only thank God when our lives are free of trouble and difficulty? Is that the only time God is good? Church, I know that you know that God is good all the time.
Amen.
The Bible teaches that our circumstances do not dictate God's goodness. God's character dictates his goodness. God can't be good one moment and not the next. He can't be good in one situation and not another. The song says, hold on to his unchanging hand. He is our rock of refuge to which we can always go. Not sometime, but all the time. Not just when things are going the way we want them to, but in every life situation. Sadly, this is easier said than done. When the going gets tough, our cheerleaders will tell us, make lemonade out of lemons. Walk on the sunny side of the street. Look on the bright side of life. But God tells us, hold on. I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper and not harm you. Focusing on what we lack is a bad habit that robs us of the joy that's available to us every day and renders invisible many of the great things we already have. It also makes it hard for us to notice when something new and good comes across our path. It's a kind of myopic vision that limits our view of the world based on our list of haves and have-nots. We've all done it at some time. The planning and plotting and working for the things we now have. And shortly after we obtain them, they've lost their luster. We've stopped appreciating them. And quicker still, we turn anew to something that we don't yet have. It's like a hot pursuit of a new relationship, only to become disenchanted and lose interest shortly thereafter. It's like always having to have the latest and greatest and newest iPhone. Truth is, we're only as happy as we are grateful for the things we've already had. So, do you focus on too much negative and not on the positive of what you have? Let me throw out a couple of examples of a positive versus negative psyche and see if any of them resound in your spirit. You secretly feel envious often. Envy is a significant yet useless emotion we struggle with. When you learn of someone else getting something good or doing better, your immediate reaction is resentment and or jealousy. You only see others are having something better than you. But But of course, that's because you don't have the gratitude to appreciate what's right in front of your face. You turn compliments upside down. Now, I find this more so in women than men. Mm-hmm. And I have to admit being guilty of it from time to time. Should someone pay you a compliment, you find a way to turn it on its head. Someone will say something like, "I like your outfit." And you'll say, "This old thing." Or they'll say, "You look great." And you'll say, "Girl, you should see my hair under this hat." You won't even allow other people to show appreciation for the things you have.
My Lord.
The statement, "I'm abundant," feels false. "I'm abundant" is the new version of "I'm blessed and highly favored." Now, does anybody know that? Am I just the last one? And if you don't feel comfortable saying that, then you probably don't genuinely think you have much in life. And the fact that you don't feel that is true about you just means you're what? Focusing on what you don't have. If you always focus on what you have, you will never have enough. Focus on what you can do with what you've got. In other words, count your blessings. Name them one by one. Mm-hmm. Count your blessings and see the many mighty things that God has done. We each have so much to appreciate. We Christians should be the most grateful, joyful, thankful people on planet Earth. The words "thank you, God" should ceaselessly flow from our mouths. Truth is, when life gets hard, it can be even harder to give thanks to God and so much easier to forget all his blessings. That is why we need to constantly be reminded of all the reasons we have to say, "Thank you, Lord." Mm-hmm. You've been so good. For every mountain you brought me over, for every trial you see me through, for every blessing, hallelujah,
yes,
for
yes,
this, I give you praise.
Amen.
Because just giving thanks to God reminds us of how much we actually have. We humans are prone to covetousness, that excessive desire for wealth and material possessions. When focusing on what we don't have. By giving thanks continually, we are reminded of how much we do have and focus on the blessings rather than wants. When we start thanking God for things we usually take for granted, our outlook changes and we are more in sync with God. We realize that we could not exist, that we are nothing without his bountiful, merciful blessings. Feelings and expressing appreciation is a good thing. God wants us to learn to be thankful for every good and perfect gift that comes from above. Without gratitude, we become arrogant and self-centered, believing it's all about me. All this is me. And everything I've achieved and acquired is because of me. That we are responsible for our own triumphs and successes. Thankfulness keeps us from getting the big head and remain humble and our hearts in a right relationship to the true giver of good gifts. The Bible is filled with commands to give thanks to God. Notice I didn't say suggestions or requests.
All right.
But commands.
Yeah.
Like the Ten Commandments. Most verses break it down and explain how and why we should show our debt gratitude. His love endures forever.
All right.
Good reason. His mercy is everlasting. I like that too. Give thanks in all circumstances. That I have to work on. We can't effectively praise and worship God without also being thankful. They go hand in hand. They're a match set. As 1 Thessalonians says, in everything give thanks. For this is God's will for you in Christ. We are to be thankful, not only for the things we like winning a multi-million dollar lottery, but also for the things that we don't like paying taxes. When we purpose to thank God for everything that He allows to come into our lives, we keep bitterness away from our spirit.
Yes.
We cannot be both thankful and bitter at the same time.
That's right.
We can't serve two masters. We don't thank God for evil, but we are grateful that He sustains us through. We don't thank Him for harm He didn't cause, but we do appreciate the strength He gives us to endure it. We thank Him for His promise that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him. We can have thankful hearts toward God, even when we don't feel thankful for the situation. We can grieve and still be thankful. We can hurt and still be thankful. Giving thanks to God keeps our hearts in right relationship with Him and saves us from a hot mess of harmful emotions and attitudes that would rob us of all peace that surpasses all understanding. The 103rd Psalm says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all His benefits." We are prone to forget His benefits and need to constantly call them to mind. Thank you, God, for your presence in my life. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Thank you, God, for meeting my needs. And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of His glory in Christ Jesus. Thank you, God, for loving me when I was unlovable.
Well.
But God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Yeah.
Thank you, God, for saving my soul. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, for hearing and answering my prayers according to your will. Mm-hmm. I call on you, my God, for you will answer me. Turn your ear to me and hear my prayer. Thank you, God, for strength when I am weak. Mm. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Thank you, God, for a calling and a purpose to my life. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of His own purpose and grace. So sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God, the Father of everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Now, I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to also urge, to encourage, to ask, to beg you, if you haven't already, to get out and vote. Bad public officials get elected when good people don't vote. And I promise you, voting is 1,000% more effective than complaining about it on the internet after it's all said and done.
All right.
Get out and vote like you have a pre-existing medical condition and they're threatening to cut off Obamacare in the midst of a pandemic. Mm-hmm. Vote like you're the parents of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, or Trayvon Martin. Vote like you're paying tribute to the late great civil rights leader, John Lewis, who said, vote like you've never voted before.
Yes.
Get into trouble.
Yes.
Good trouble. Necessary trouble. Vote like your life depends on it, because it does. When we all vote, we can change the world. Mm-hmm. Vote. 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 opposed. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What a wonderful word from God. We need to be thankful for what we have instead of looking at what we don't have, you know. We can flip that script very easily. Is your glass half empty or is it half full? And even if it's a quarter full, it's still some full. We need to think positive. We want to thank Ms. Esther Lloyd Stevenson for that great message. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. This is Lady Sunday, and ladies, you have led the way. We want to thank Ms. Ravina Maynard for reading the scripture and for her prayer. And of course, we want to thank Ms. Esther Lloyd Stevenson for the word today. Now, you can bless this ministry by sharing. Hit the share button so you can start a watch party so someone else can see this word. And you can also give to the church. We have five ways that you can give. You can go online at EPFM, that's EPFMUMC.org, and give there. You can give through the Give Plus app. You can text the amount that you want to give to 404-567-5052. That's 404-567-5052. You can also mail a check to the church at 2651, that's 2651 Church Street, East Point, Georgia, 30344. That's, you can also drive by the church and put it into our mail slot. Our mail slot is locked, so you can actually put cash in the mail slot. Thank you for worshiping with us today. May God continue to bless you. We hope that something happened that will touch your life, not just for a day, but for weeks and months to come. Now have a wonderfully blessed day, and know that God loves you.